some functioning as we get older, and that's just the reality of general cognitive decline. But you can sort of offset the loss of function by doing significant types of cognitive tasks, like learning second languages, being involved in book clubs, taking courses at university, going to public events where you're learning new concepts. So you can sort of offset cognitive delay by challenging the brain. Norman Doidge, in his book, The Brain That Changes Itself, really sort of awoke in the public about the Arrowsmith work. In his book, The Brain That Changes Itself, his chapter two is all about the Arrowsmith program. And in fact, those watching from Australia and New Zealand, once his book came out, we got flooded at our school at UBC with Australians and people from New Zealand. It was a very, very, very big bestseller in Australia and New Zealand. And our school almost became half Australian. So thank you, Australia, for increasing our enrollment. And in fact, I'd walk the hallways, I wouldn't know if I was actually in Australia or Vancouver. The accents of the Australians were everywhere, and I think some of our teachers were picking up the accent as well. But his book really has revolutionized the field. It's made a lot of people aware of the concept of neuroplasticity and brain change. And again, chapter two in his book is about the Arrowsmith program and Barbara Arrowsmith Young, who's really has altered the lives of myself, the teachers that work here, the students that are doing the Arrowsmith program. She is, in my mind, a remarkable genius with incredible insight and ability to synthesize very complex problems and be remarkably creative in creating the exercises that these students are working on. I mean, this has been 35 years of work on her behalf out of Toronto, Canada. And when I look at the work and I see what she has done, it's truly a remarkable accomplishment as an individual, and certainly as the research, more research gets published at UBC and Southern Illinois University, I think there'll be more and more recognition at the academic level, at the research level, the power of the work that is currently a result of her remarkable mind. And her work has affected thousands and thousands of students across the world, mostly at this time in Canada, but certainly the impact is being felt in the United States. Of course, Australia has developed a lot of schools that are incorporating the Arrowsmith program, New Zealand as well, and international schools in Asia, some are picking up the Arrowsmith program as well. So there's a lot of data just in Arrowsmith of the thousands and thousands of students that have been involved. And these students are really neural sculptors. They're restructuring, reorganizing their brain. Now this also happens in public schools and private schools where there isn't Arrowsmith. Arrowsmith isn't the only thing sculpting the brain. Parents are helping kids sculpt the brain, whether they get them involved in extracurricular activities. Private schools who might do three languages or require three languages for kids are sculpting the brain and changing it. Public schools are also sculpting the human brain. So we're all responsible for guiding children and improving neurological functioning. What's interesting with the Arrowsmith program, as you'll see tonight in the live cognitive classroom, a lot of these students are purposely sculpting the brain. They know they're doing it. I think what's probably not true in schools today, many children in schools don't really realize that they're actually sculpting the human brain or themselves as they learn. With the Arrowsmith kids, they actually know why they're involved in the program. They know that the purpose is to restructure and the function of the human brain. They know this is their purpose as they work through it. We have a whole bunch of researchers involved in looking at Arrowsmith. These are just a select few of them. These are researchers who are independent of Arrowsmith. They do not get paid by the Arrowsmith program. They work at universities in Canada and in the United States. They are third party to the program itself. In fact, as the director of research part of the work I do, I'm director of the research efforts of the Arrowsmith program. My job is to try to find a researcher who's interested in looking at Arrowsmith and studying it, connect with them, talk with them. I might try to help find funding for them through philanthropy. But once they get going, I basically don't hear from them. It's kind of, I wish I could sit in their labs, research labs, and watch the scans come through and then talk to their graduate students and give them input and advice, but I don't. I'm just a total third party. I wait and wait and wait and wait for them to come to us saying that we're going to publish, this is where the journal is going to be published in, and I don't even know if the results are going to be good or not. That's how distant we are from this research. I mean, some companies actually hire researchers who work for their company and pay them and then monitor them and guide them. But the Arrowsmith program does not do that. These are people with high integrity, these researchers who are independent of our work, and we allow them or give them the Arrowsmith program in terms of the students that are going to work on it. They then on their own start analyzing the data and come up with their findings. We have had, fortunately, some presentations from researchers to the public where they shared some of their findings, and I'm going to talk about some of that with you today. One of the studies I want to talk about is taking place at the University of British Columbia. Some of this data was presented in June of 2016 to the public. So this isn't new to some people, but some in Australia and New Zealand who haven't seen this around the world, or some here may not have seen this research. And it's beginning to show some really fascinating findings. And this is the research from Dr. Lara Boyd and her other researchers. There's about four or five other researchers involved at UBC at the Brain Behavior Lab. And they took Eaton Arrowsmith School students who are at UBC, White Rock, and Redmond, Washington, where we have sites, and ask parents, would you like to have your child scanned with brain imaging? Would you like them to participate in behavioral assessments of cognitive functioning and achievement testing before they do Arrowsmith? And then we're going to measure them 3 months into Arrowsmith, a year after Arrowsmith. And in fact, now they're looking at data 2 years into Arrowsmith. The Arrowsmith program can be roughly 3 years of length in terms of intervention. This study that I'll be talking about, this part of the study was 1 year into Arrowsmith, and some of the data is from 3 months. And so for this data, there were, in the Eaton Arrowsmith group here, there were 56 participants with learning disabilities who were a part of the experimental group. 26 were girls, 30 were boys, roughly in the ages of 9 to 16 years of age, with the average age being about 12.5 years. And then there was a controls with learning disabilities, and these were students mostly in the Vancouver School Board, some might have been in Surrey School Board. And there were 18 participants in the control group, 4 girls, 14 boys, again, same age range, 9 to 17, with the average age 13 years of age. And then there was a typically developing controls. These were kids without learning disabilities that they wanted to compare to the other groups. There were 15 participants, 8 girls, 7 boys, again, 9 to 17 years of age, 12 years average. They all had to be right-handed, no left-handers, which is unfortunate, but in terms of brain imaging, sometimes the brain shows up opposite to the hand that you're using, so they want to control for handedness. Being left-handed, I would have been excluded. And I think there's a lot of kids with dyslexia left-handers that would have been excluded. I think one of the things Dr. Boyd wants to do is add them into the group and see what that looks like. These kids were put into scanners pre-Arrowsmith or prior to the Arrowsmith program, 3 months into it, 1 year into it, and looked at these intervals. What's interesting, the Arrowsmith program, for those who may not be aware, is a very intensive cognitive intervention program. The students at Eaton Arrowsmith School were doing 6 blocks out of 8 a day of Arrowsmith, which is roughly 35 to 40 minutes per block. They were doing this 5 days a week for this period of time. So this is a very intensive cognitive intervention program. It's not like CogMed or Luminosity or Fast Forward, in that many of those interventions are 8 to 10 weeks, sometimes 6 to 10 weeks of length for 45 minutes a day, sometimes just 3 days a week. So the kids in Arrowsmith are probably getting, I know they're getting the most cognitive intervention in terms of intensity and repetition that any other program offers around the world. And I think that's part of the success of Arrowsmith we see with our students, and you'll see in some of this research, is that intensity and that repetition. The brain is not easily or readily changed. It takes a lot of time, a lot of effort. It's not something you can, if you're learning juggling, you can't just practice for an hour of juggling and expect to be a master juggler. You might spend 2, 3, 4 months of it, an hour a day, and become quite proficient because your brain is changing its visual motor functioning, visual spatial functioning, as it develops a mastery for juggling. So the students that you'll see today, some have been here 2 years, some just 3 months with the Arrowsmith program, and they've already had hours and hours of cognitive change or cognitive training as they move through. So we wanted to see, the reason they put 3 months here is that we often notice, and parents notice, the first changes in their children at 3 months of intervention. And so we wanted to see what happens at 3 months. And then again, at the end of the school year, we wanted to see. So they did brain imaging, they did behavioral testing, they used the Woodcock-Johnson test of cognitive ability and achievement, which is often quite a common tool that psychologists use in the school system around North America. This is the group mean. This is the Woodcock-Johnson, that measures cognitive functioning. And when I say cognitive functioning, I mean things like memory, reasoning, executive functioning, visual motor, visual auditory learning. So it has quite a broad range of brain functions that it looks at. And then it measures achievement. And with that, I mean reading, writing, spelling, and math, for example. What's interesting here is that the LD controls, who were from the public school, mostly a few from private, their cognitive and achievement scores at the start of this research were slightly lower than the Arrowsmith or Eaton Arrowsmith students. So the Eaton Arrowsmith students prior to the research seemed to have a slight cognitive and achievement advantage. It's quite possible that these families are very progressive in intervention and have done a lot of things even before the Arrowsmith program has started. So they might have been slightly elevated in compared to the control group. What's even more interesting is the healthy controls tended to show the best ability in cognition and achievement, which makes sense because they don't have learning disabilities. 100 is considered age level scores or grade level scores. So you can see that the LD groups were below their grade or age levels. And I'm going to just show you one slide. I'm not able to share the whole study because I haven't seen it. I've been given glimpses of some of the data, but right now Dr. Lara Boyd is in the process of publishing this research, and so it's off to a journal. It has to be peer-reviewed, then sent back to her probably for edits, and then it's actually accepted and published. But I can share pieces of it. This is an interesting finding, which just shows the general progress that Arrowsmith students make versus kids who are just in a public school not doing intensive cognitive intervention. What we can see is that, in general, the kids, the LD controls, ones in public schools, their cognitive increase and improvement is not as high as those kids in the Arrowsmith program. And I'll get to questions afterwards. Now, what's interesting is not that they didn't make improvement in a public school. They still improved cognition in terms of change, but not as close as to where the Arrowsmith students made. So what this says is that even if your child's in the public school working with the learning disabilities, they're still, on average, improving cognition. That's good news. So if you're in that, what's exciting for the Arrowsmith program is that if you're doing intensive cognitive intervention like you'll see today, you're going to even get more cognitive change. And that's important, especially if you have a learning disability, because the cause of a learning disability is cognitive weaknesses. What's even more dramatic, though, is that the kids in the Arrowsmith program made far better improvement in terms of achievement, reading, writing, spelling, and math. Again, these are groups. These are composite scores. So they, if they take cognition and all the measures and collapse them and average them. So the same for achievement. It took reading, writing, spelling, and math, collapsed them and averaged them. And if you took a composite score, the Arrowsmith students did quite a bit better in achievement-related issues. Of course, a bit scary with the kids, LD healthy, or sort of the LD controls in the public schools, they sort of had on a collective average a slight drop in achievement over that year, which is sort of scary if you have a child in a public system. Now, what's important to note is these scales, these lines here, up and down, this is the frequency or the distribution of scores. So in fact, you know, there are some kids who scored fairly high with achievement change, and some even scored even well below grade level. They dropped quite dramatically over time. And even in cognition, there's quite a spread of scores. And so when you look at this, you say, well, that's pretty good for the Arrowsmith program in terms of overall averages. What Dr. Boyd has done in her research is has taken pieces out like math and looked at areas of cognition that are important in math and looked at have those changed over time. Or took areas of the brain involved in reading and looked at the brain images and said, have areas of the brain changed in terms of reading development? And that's part of what she's looking at for publication. But again, it shows, you know, evidence from the Brain Behavior Lab at UBC that the Arrowsmith program is having an impact when compared to LD controls, kids who aren't doing the Arrowsmith program. What's even more interesting to me is when you go into the slides themselves, into the images, you begin to see what's happening in the brain as kids are doing these activities. Today you'll see someone doing the clocks exercise, or what we call symbol relations. The clocks exercise is one where kids are learning how to see cause and effect or relationships between concepts. So if you're learning a clock, a two-handed clock, an hour and a minute, there's a relationship between those hands. And as the minute hand changes, the hour hand slightly changes. And you have to understand what that relationship is. It's a reasoning cause and effect task. And there are certain areas of the brain that light up when you're doing this task. And that's what Dr. Boyd did with her team, is create an actual clocks task inside a functional MRI machine. So the children were sitting on their back, looking up at the screen, and seeing a clock up above them. Remember, it's, you know, there's a strange sounds going on, you feel like you're in a tunnel. But you see this clock face, and then you see the answer, and you have to sort of say, is this right or wrong? And is the time correct or not correct? And you had to use one of your fingers to press yes or no, because you don't want a lot of movement in the scanner. You have to be really still, or else it'll mess up the image. But they were able to design this with some of the graduate students. One in particular designed this clock task. And because of that, they were able to see what happens when you look at a clock, when you look at an analog clock. And the first slide here, time point zero, is prior to treatment. So it's prior to them doing the clocks activity that, again, you'll see with these students. And what you'll see is quite a bit of activity. The yellow is sort of the areas of the brain that are lighting up as the students are engaged in this task. Quite a lot of prefrontal activity is taking place in this brain. And then we looked at it 3 months later, Dr. Boyd did it. I wish I was sitting in the lab with them. I want to do a PhD with them. It's so hard to watch it from afar. But they looked at the images again. They put the kids back in the scanner who did the Arrowsmith program and wanted to see what was the change in functioning. And what was clear is that when you look at time point zero and time 3 months, there's less activity. And again, that's a sign that we assume is a sign of mastery. As your brain gets more efficient, it uses less of the brain, and it develops this automaticity. And that makes it easier to do other things at the same time, to multitask as you're working through activities. So as they do this work that you see here, they're actually fine-tuning the human brain. Instead of using a whole variety of areas of the brain, cortex, trying to figure out what's going on, the brain is to create these sort of super highways of connectivity so they actually can operate faster and more efficiently. So they actually speed up and you're more efficient in terms of the brain. What we're also finding with this clock's activity is that it's actually affecting areas responsible for reasoning. So they already know in the human brain what areas relate to reasoning and cause and effect thinking. They've already studied that. And what they see in these images is that the Arrowsmith students are actually developing these cognitive domains. And imagine, there's 100 billion neurons in the human brain with 179,000 kilometers of axon connections. So, you know, when you look at this fine-tuning of the human brain, it's quite remarkable to think visually and conceptually how that's actually occurring. It's actually quite stunning as it moves forward. The next one, which is harder to see because it's dimmed, is looking at resting state activity, and I'll get a bit closer so you can see the outlines. The resting state activity, the kids again are put into the scanner, well, they're already in the scanner, and they're asked to just relax and not really think of anything. Just calm the mind, relax, try not to have a lot of thoughts racing through your mind. And we do this, you know, as we sleep, as we rest, we sort of mind drift away. And it's not that your brain shuts down during this time. It's still actually active. And the patterns of activity actually highlight sort of the areas of the brain that seem to be quite critical for different tasks in our lives. And what's interesting with this at time point zero here, I'm going to point here. This is an example. This is the human brain here. It's hard to see the actual outline. But at the front here, you see this little red dot here. Not my dot, but another dot. That's the prefrontal lobe. That's right here, right in the front. This is considered our executive brain for planning and organizing and executing tasks in our lives. What they started to notice at the Brain Behavioral Lab is some of the students with learning disabilities had less activity in the prefrontal that sort of goes away from what's normal in a normal human brain or a controlled human brain that doesn't have a learning disability. There seems to be an underactivity of the prefrontal lobe at resting state, which makes one wonder, why is that the case versus controls? Why is there less prefrontal activity in these students with learning disabilities? And of course, I have my assumption, this isn't from the Brain Behavioral Lab, they may have a similar assumption, is that throughout the life of someone with a learning disability, give them the answer, help them with their calendars, guide them through their lives, become their executive assistants. I mean, if you're a parent here of a child with a learning disability, who hasn't been through Arrowsmith, you might know what that is like, that you're always doing stuff and reminding them of what they have to get done. And if that's the case, if that's what we do at school with learning resource rooms in terms of scaffolding and helping them, giving them accommodations, if we do that at home because the child is just struggling to do it on their own, it may result in the underactivation of the executive brain or the frontal lobe, which is a negative. It's not a good thing because it makes them struggle with real time on tasks that they're trying to get done, to pay attention, to execute on their ideas or thoughts that they have in their mind. So in fact, the current paradigm in learning disabilities may actually have some negative impact in life outcomes. We think we're helping them. We think we're making life easier for them, because we are. We're helping them with learning resource room, we're guiding them to their tutors, working with them at home on their assignments. But the neurological impact of all that guidance may not be a positive. And after 3 months of the Arrowsmith program, this intensive cognitive activity, and almost every exercise you'll see today does stress the executive brain in terms of attention and planning and executing what they have to do. So it's constantly being exercised as they do these activities. And what you see in 3 months, that same area that has a small sort of activation in this one example, this one case study, has far greater activation after just 3 months. We've also seen similar things with traumatic brain injury and work with Arrowsmith, as it takes about 3 months and we see greater activation in this frontal lobe and better test scores on attention and executive processing. So, and you wonder too, with 100 billion cells, it looks like a small dot. I mean, obviously we see the change, but how many hundreds of thousands of cells have been activated that weren't activated before? How many kilometers of axons are now interconnected that they weren't before? I mean, again, we have to think scale of this. It could be quite stunning as we sort of get deeper into this. So again, to sum it up, and I'll go to the slide in a minute, Dr. Lara Boyd, her research over 1 year certainly showing changes that are very positive in terms of the impact of the Arrowsmith program. There's one caveat, though, there's one important point, is that every single student who does the Arrowsmith program is really a single subject design. There are some kids who show remarkable progress cognitively than everyone else. They're like these outliers. They have this remarkably plastic brain. And then even the cognitive teachers go, wow, that's quick that they mastered these levels so fast. And then there are other students that make progress that's very slow and very frustrating for them. And there doesn't seem to be as much plasticity or brain change. And there's some outliers, 1 out of 10 students who try Arrowsmith, we don't seem to be able to make a change for them. So it's not a panacea for everybody. And then there's average cognitive change that we see in students doing Arrowsmith. So there really is, when you look at research doing Arrowsmith, there's a variety of changes. Everyone's different in terms of how they respond to the program. In research, we take averages, which sort of hides individual differences. And I think, I know Barbara Arrowsmith Young, myself, the researchers that I've chatted with are really as interested in the individual differences, obviously, as the average. The averages allow you to say, we have significant change, Arrowsmith is making a positive impact on these students' lives. Looking at the individual data allows you to say, why are some kids progressing more than others? Is it exercise? Is it genetics? Is it stress? Or are some kids more anxious doing Arrowsmith and therefore they don't progress as much? Is it diet, nutrition, omega-3s, eat more rabbit or fish, whatever it might be, vegetables, don't drink as much Coca-Cola, whatever the impact, because we know sugar is a toxicity for a lot of the human body. So there's a lot of really fascinating things to learn, and I think that's what's exciting, that the Arrowsmith program, yes, it will start publishing this research from, or researchers will start publishing from universities about Arrowsmith, but it's only just the beginning. It won't, in my lifetime, I won't live to see all the research that could be done with Arrowsmith, because it's such a complex program addressing a complex number of cognitive activities and impacting achievement, but not just achievement, but social development in terms of relationships and understanding people and making sense of social pragmatics and also changing the executive brain, being to follow instructions and know how to execute ideas. It's such a remarkable program that way in terms of its breadth of impact. In the field of learning disabilities, we spend so much time on reading and achievement, we forget that there's so many other things that kids with learning disabilities have to deal with. This is the definition of learning disabilities, and this is information that we need to change over time. This is just pieces of the definition. I just want to show some of the information from the Learning Disabilities Association definition re-endorsed in March of 2015. Learning disabilities talk about specific neurological disorders. I would say yes, and they're, you know, pretty much neurological differences in brain functioning. So we agree on that part of the definition, that every child, every human has a different neurological makeup. They have differences in how they process, memorize and conceptualize and retrieve information. I think the big difference that I think we have to change over time, based on the research that's coming out from Dr. Boyd's lab, Dr. Greg Rose from Southern Illinois University, is this concept that it's lifelong. I think that's a very debilitating concept to have in the definition. Because if you're trained as a teacher, say at the University of British Columbia or in Australia, and you're told that learning disabilities are lifelong, and then Arrowsmith program comes along and says, no, the brain's plastic, kids can sort of shift out of the learning disability diagnosis, at least some of them, that challenges their thinking, because they've been trained by professors that learning disabilities are lifelong. So how dare you say that they can change, that these kids can actually outgrow some of these learning challenges, which are only neurological differences. Like if you can change that prefrontal lobe and light it up so that all of a sudden they have a much stronger executive brain, that means that you may not have to have that type of learning difficulty for the rest of your life. The other thing too is the types of strategies they recommend are things like coping skills, solid coping skills and strategies. And nowhere in the definition does it talk about cognitive training. And I think the reason is it does need more research. You know, I don't blame the Learning Disability Association of Canada for having this definition. They need research to change it. And I think the research coming out of the Arrowsmith program in these universities will begin to get the board of directors of learning disability associations or learning difficulties in Australia to rethink the definition and the lifelong implications of having these difficulties. And we need a different mindset on this. I think the paradigm in learning disabilities or difficulties is a fixed mindset, that these kids have these issues for the rest of their life. I do think that the reading research on dyslexia, I think a lot of them understand the brain's plastic, that if you teach phonics, sound symbol association, phonemes, spelling rules, that kids with reading disabilities like dyslexia can improve their capability to read because their brain is changing. Sally Shaywitz, University of or Yale University, Dr. Sally Shaywitz, have shown the brain changes with reading instruction. So I think there is the field understands that the brain can change, but they seem to be centered around reading and spelling areas of brain functioning. But if we can expand that to the prefrontal executive brain with or the reasoning segments of the human brain, that those are also plastic, that those can also change, that memory functions of the human brain can improve, then we can actually do more for kids with learning disabilities in the classroom and at home. So I think the research has to expand this growth mindset of not just in reading that the brain can change, but in so many other brain functions. And if we embrace that growth mindset, I think we can do so much more for kids with learning disabilities over time. And again, the focus has been on reading. If you look at, if you Google reading and learning disabilities, you'll get thousands and thousands of links. But if you type neuroplasticity and learning disabilities, you'll just get, you know, maybe a couple thousands to tens of thousands of links. So it's quite, you know, we're in this paradigm shift over time. And again, this idea that there are these other cognitive processes other than reading. Here's an example of a group listening to a lecture and taking notes. When someone has to do that, they have to have good auditory processing or memory for information, auditory. They have to have good note-taking skills or keyboarding skills if they have a tablet. They've got to be able to have fast reasoning in terms of seeing concepts presented to them. There's a lot of things going on neurologically when you're sitting and listening, like you are now. And so we have to understand what those capacities are and research them, and this is what we're doing with the Arrowsmith program. Again, there's a paradigm shift here, and a fundamental change in an individual's or a society's view of how things work in the world is a paradigm shift. And I've been working on that paradigm shift here in British Columbia for quite some time. I wrote the book Brain School that has gone throughout the world trying to get a paradigm shift and people to rethink what we think of kids with learning difficulties or learning disabilities. And we have to keep calm about this. And I put this up here just to remind that there are people out there, professors at universities, some in Australia, that get really upset when they hear the word Arrowsmith program. And I think they fundamentally get upset because they're in a different paradigm than the Arrowsmith program is. And they also worry that there's not enough research and that because of that, Arrowsmith program may not be doing what they say they're doing for children. But we have to remember the Arrowsmith program has been doing research since the beginning that they started. When Barbara Arrowsmith Young, 35 years ago, started Arrowsmith, she started seeing how students responded to the program. These are called case studies. That is research. It's one type of research. Then she had Dr. William Lancey from Mount Sinai Hospital or in Toronto come in as a third party to research Arrowsmith. And he saw changes as the kids' cognitive ability changed, so their achievement skills change. And he wrote articles and put them out there for people to read. That's research. May not be gold standard, but it's research. And that's 30 years ago. And now over the last 3 years, we've been doing brain imaging, or I haven't, but these researchers, Dr. Lara Boyd, Dr. Greg Rose, Dr. Rachel Weber is a new person on board, is doing research looking at brain imaging and adding controls to that research. That's getting closer to this concept of gold standard research. So progress over 30 years, 35 years, it's been research-based. And it's exciting to see. And I think as we begin to get these new brain images studies published, we'll be able to make this paradigm shift happen. Hayes is going to come up. He's the principal of the Eaton Arrowsmith School. And tell about, you know, his idea, what his he's going to be doing is explaining what the Arrowsmith program is, what is the cognitive classroom like compared to a special education resource room, for example, where students are trying to relearn concepts taught in their other classrooms. or are being given skill instruction in reading and writing and spelling. So time to watch that program. So I give it to you, Simon. Then afterwards, we'll be answering questions, both through live stream. So if you're in Australia, New Zealand, and you have a question, it'll be sent here through the internet, and we'll have one of our staff members read the question off to you. So there'll be time for question and answer.
Thank you. Okay, so if I haven't met you, my name is Simon Hayes, and I work at the University of BC, Eaton Arrowsmith School. Our school currently is comprised of about 85 students from roughly grade 2 to grade 12, and some of my students are here today. And our goal is just to give you a quick glimpse into what an exercise might look like. As Howard had mentioned there, each student is on their own individualized program. So they're not they may work beside somebody on an exercise, but they, for a different reason, they could be on a whole different level. And their program is catered specifically to their brain. And what our goal is to do is to bring each child to a level of an average functioning. This could be average for their age or their grade. It could apply to their life in the classroom. It can apply to life outside of the classroom, reading versus writing, social thinking versus problem solving in the real world. So what we're going to do today is pick four exercises, and myself and Emily, who's a principal at White Rock, will go through and describe as best we can. So we're going to start with Julia, and Julia is working on an exercise that's called Object Rec. So we'll just pull that up on the screen. I'm going to switch through here. So within our day, we have 6 and 35 minutes. We try to sustain engagement for as much as we can of that 35 minutes. You can imagine if you have attention issues, that can be difficult. So for some kids, we may need to start with 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and scale our way up to 30. And what our focus is as Howard was saying, is a lot of executive function is based on engagement abilities and how long they can focus on these exercises. So with this exercise here, it's called object recognition. So many individuals who struggle with object recognition, they might not recognize your face. You could have met them at a previous social gathering or out in the world, and then you could pass each other on the street and they might not recognize you. One classic example in children is usually incredibly messy workspaces, such as lockers or desks, and they're just flooded with paper and erasers and pencils. At home, their bedrooms are very messy in their personal spaces. They tend to lose a lot of things. So what Julia is working on here is trying to visually recognize this object. And when she has to close her eyes and take a snapshot of it, you can think of an object. Let's say we all use a phone. Think of your phone. You can close your eyes and pretty much envision what that phone would look like, exactly where your home screen is, where all your icons are. However, if you can't have that visualization, it's pretty much like a blank slate. So you would miss finer details of things. So you could miss people's facial features if they're upset with you. You might not even recognize it. So she's looking at one object and then having to visually scan through a series of other objects to try and find that one that she's looking for. They're very small details, often very subtle. And what we'd want to do then is increase the number of objects that she's having to find. So she would spend 35 minutes doing something like this, and we would start as little as one object, and you can go as many as 8. Next, we're going to have Emily come up, and Emily's going to quickly describe the exercise of tracing.
Hello, everybody. My name is Emily Lenny, and I am the principal of Eaton Arrowsmith School out in White Rock. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about our symbolic thinking exercise, also known as Elthic. Pochaboaz is working on down there. this exercise supports our ability to think, plan, and problem solve in language-based situations. So a lot like Howard was mentioning about that executive function, which is why we call it elephant. We're trying to target that prefrontal cortex on the left side there. So this exercise helps build up those skills. So a student who might struggle with that ability might have trouble with organization. They might have difficulty being able to prioritize their tasks and, you know, be able to be self-directed in their work. The very important skills in a classroom, in a work environment, and just in life in general. So, Boaz, I'm just wondering if you'd be able to share a little bit about your story.
Yep. Okay, so Elfink is, just so you guys have a bit of an idea, it's kind of just a paragraph of random text, and you need to kind of find the main idea of what the text is getting at. Before I had difficulty kind of comprehending what I was reading, I could decode it, but I couldn't understand what, you know, what the main idea of the text was. And that became easier, especially with articles I wasn't interested in, like politics. And I always wanted to kind of know what it all meant, but yeah, that's been a lot easier. And yeah, so in March, which was actually 3 months after I started, I was in Utah at a museum, and I was just kind of reading all this stuff I wouldn't usually gravitate towards, and I found myself totally taking it all in, which was very cool. Yeah.
Thank you, Louis. Luca, who's right beside him there, is working on a different exercise. It's called tracing. And this exercise helps support our ability to develop motor plans. We actually have two exercises that address this area, word and tracing. We have motor plans for writing, that's our written output, and that fine motor control when we're printing and writing. These motor plans that we have for hundreds of words that allow us to, you know, go to write a word. We don't have to think very hard about that word. There's already a plan in our hand and in our brain of how to write that word. Someone who struggles with this has to spend a lot of time thinking about how to form each letter, how to write each word. They don't have many developed motor plans. We also have motor plans for reading as well. This allows our eyes to be able to follow across the line, eye track, you know, when we're reading in a book or off the board, so that we're not skipping words or skipping lines. We also have motor plans for speaking. This allows us to speak in those smooth sentences, so important for spoken output as well. So Luca's working on that, and if he turns around for a second there, you'll see he is wearing an eye patch. That's usually something when we have student visitors come, one of the first things they notice, they're like, what's with all the eye patches? Yes, we wear an eye patch on our left eye. We're trying to limit the visual input to only come in through our right eye. We're trying to target that motor strip on our left side. So we do wear an eye patch for this exercise. You know, it's a little different, but the students get used to it after a while. And Luca, I don't know if you wanted to share a little bit about your story. Luca's come to us from Australia here.
I started at the White Box School 4 or 5 months ago. I transferred to Vancouver. I guess tracing, it's helped me read a bit better when I started. I used to like skip words. I still skip words when I write a bit. But yeah, I've started to become a bit better at that, I guess.
Thank you.
So as you can see, if I'm on camera here, all of our students are working away. So this is exactly what a classroom would look like. They would have to sustain, you know, if there's distraction going on around them, their goal is to focus. And you can see here today, obviously, you know, as we're talking, they're keeping going. And that's what we're looking for all the time. We're going to pull up the clocks exercise now. If I can just push these buttons down. Okay, and on the clocks exercise, just going to skip to the next screen. Our goal is reasoning, as Howard said. So we're focusing on the cause and effect thinking and the relationship between each hand. You can see here on a two-handed clock, we don't often learn how the hand relates to the minute. I think many times now we use our phone, and the watch industry is probably going down because of this, but we're learning on a digital clock usually. However, the relationship between each hand on the hour hand and the minute is very precise, and we want to teach this. Many kids, when they come in, they don't quite understand before and after. You could say to them, next week is a birthday party and we're going to go on Wednesday. And they might incessantly ask you every single day when that birthday party is, because that moment of time next week has no relation to what they're feeling in that moment. And time is very abstract, how a day relates to a month, how the month relates to the year, and the year to the decade, and so on. So it's very much a placement in that. And when we're thinking outside of that, how does X plus 5 equal 10? That's a relationship. How does that letter then relate to the answer in that equation? So what the child here is doing, or the young adult too, is sitting and reading these clocks as fast as they can. This increases processing speed. This increases visual processing. It increases mathematical processing. Social thinking and being able to read a room, you're really having to think about multiple people at the same time and how you're interacting with them. So once that is no longer difficult, we then would increase another hand into the situation. In this case, it might be a second hand to break down a minute. I'm going to quickly jump to Kaylin. I'm very impressed by Kaylin, not just because he's my student, but he also goes so fast. And when we start, we might want to focus on typing speed. You know, I can teach you this concept, but you can't go as fast as Kaylin. And it will take some time to get there. And when we go through, we hit a point of what Howard was referring to as mastery. And when a challenge is no longer difficult, we say you've mastered that task. I think Malcolm Gladwell used the 10,000 hours as a marker, which we often associate to what it takes to get to mastery. And for some it's not that long, but for some it might be, it depends on the task. And you see here, Kaylin's just firing away with a goal, you see in the top right corner, of 90% accuracy. So we're keeping score as we go, and then at the end of each day, we're trying to track this progress. And we look at the time, we look at the percentages, and that helps the teacher then guide exactly what's going on in the classroom. We've gone through what the classroom looks like. At our schools, and some in Australia and around the world, are offering 4 Arrowsmith exercises. We're offering 6 Arrowsmith and 2 academic classes. So we focus on math and English. In elementary school and into high school, our goal is to look at the foundational aspects of learning and associate that with what is going on in their Arrowsmith and cognitive profiles. And from that point, we are then trying to match those two. So, you know, some kids can read, but they can't comprehend what they're reading. Some kids have difficulties with decoding and would have to read things many, many times before they can actually understand what's going on.
I'm wondering if we could hear from Michael. I know he's been working on our clocks exercise your way. And if you had some, you know, words you wanted to share about yourself or about changes you may have noticed?
Yeah, sure. Hope it's you guys. Before I came to the program, I had a very messy room. My mom always nagged me about it, and I was just very reckless when it came to time management and, you know, all the essentials for just everyday living. And, you know, making connections with stuff that I thought were completely unrelated, that idea was completely out of the cards for me until I got here. It's my second year here. the thing, what I love about clocks the most is what I've noticed personally for me, you see subtle improvements in everyday life because clocks exercise is one of the more plastic exercises. And, you know, when I first started, I was looking for instant gratification right away because I'm still young and stubborn, but, you know, this program helped me become more patient, and I had to, you know, trust, and I had to, and eventually I got to enjoy the process once you see results. And a couple of examples are, I was walking to the bus to get to school, and I noticed my pocket was a little lighter because some change has fell out of my pocket, and I saw it, you know, when I turned around, and I thought, wait a second, if it's here, I'm pretty sure there's more change, you know, down the street. And I put two and two together, and that's thanks to clocks because of the relationships with the hands. It also has a direct application to, you know, almost anything you think of. So it's just been it's a struggling thing to do sometimes, but once you see the results come in, you gives you a little bit of more motivation to get up in the morning, and you start to enjoy it. And I'm at that point now, and I'm still looking forward to it, to growing and improving. And what I loved about, besides the every application, is it allows you, for me, it gets me to think more, in the sense that I'm thinking about, you know, what I want to do with my life, and, you know, just think deeply and read situations all over, from, you know, from jobs, from social situations to, you know, future relationships. And that's really been helpful because of this program. And it's not for everyone, but it's really helped me, and I know there's still a ways for me to go. My journey's not done, but I'm really enjoying it. So, there you go, guys.
Thank you. How about you, Kaylin? Did you want to say anything? Of course you can finish. So close. I think what Michael was speaking about is the dedication and the drive that it takes to do this. And Kaylin just moved on to a new level. I think that's why he wanted to keep going. But Kaylin, how about you? Do you want to describe sort of what was the difference between now and where you were before when you came to our school? Do you want to turn or stand up and come over here?
Sure.
Before I went to the school, I was like, I wrote a lot sloppier, and I wrote slower, and I read a lot. Like, I couldn't read as quickly, and I wasn't as good as reading. And, like, for example, if there's something after something and I got distracted, and like a sentence after a sentence in a book, and I got distracted and came back and read the sentence, I would just be totally confused, and I would have to go back and read it again and stuff. So, and now that doesn't happen to me as much, which is good. And also, like, I'm better, my writing is way better. Like, I do cursive and it's way better. And I find I love to read, because before I couldn't really read as much very well. I mean, I didn't like it. I would just look at pictures and stuff. And now I actually love to read, and I actually want to read. And I found that was so amazing. Last year I found that, and I was just like, I was really happy. It has been great being able to read better. And also, I have been making better choices and stuff, and remembering stuff better, and yeah.
Thank you so much. So, essentially that's what the cognitive classroom looks like at all times. There are multiple exercises going on at the same time. There are students who have similar levels but are doing different things. We have a number of exercises that we don't have here to show today, but there's roughly about 14 that we can work with. There's 19 areas, but I'd say commonly for younger kids in my school, we work with about 14 of the Arrowsmith exercises. And you can be side by side somebody who is 50 years older than you and still working on a level that would stimulate your cognitive capacity. So you know, we have classrooms from, as I said, roughly grade 1 to grade 12. Most kids come into the school around grade 3. And they're working side by side and on their own programs, but in a class and group setting, because there's also a lot of group dynamics that comes into this, and motivating each other and cheering each other on. And you know, the drive for social interaction is obviously there in children, regardless of cognitive capacities. So Emily's going to come up and talk a little bit about how we bring in other areas of mindfulness and exercise and some of the things that help also build cognitive capacities as well.
So the Arrowsmith Program and the cognitive exercises, these are just a few, but all of them that we do, they are the foundation of the program. But there are also other elements that all of our schools and sites offer as well that are important for student progress. First and foremost, we create a supportive, trusting environment. Often when students and families come to our school, there's a lot of anxiety and pain from their previous experiences in the classroom, or with teachers, or classmates, or peers. We understand that our need to feel safe, to feel accepted, and that we belong is our fundamental needs. They must be met before we're ready to learn, before we're ready and able to engage in this work. So it's through relationships, attachment, community that help meet these needs for these students, helps lower that anxiety, that fear, and help build that connection and culture. We know that when we are anxious or worried, our amygdala, that emotional center of our brain, gets all worked up. And we can't access our prefrontal cortex to make those good decisions and to be able to plan and problem solve and learn. So when we can, you know, have that sense of community and connection, that helps keep that amygdala calm and settled, and we can access our prefrontal cortex as well as our hippocampus as well, which is important for learning. It's our memory centers of our brain. So you know, it's really important, that community, that connection, and it also helps us feel good, right? We get that dopamine flowing, that feel-good chemical, which is also motivating for our students. It makes them want to come to school, want to do this day after day, which wasn't always the experience at their previous schools. Also, that help keep our amygdala cool and calm, we use mindfulness. So all of our schools and sites incorporate mindfulness daily with all of our students. We use the Mind Up program, which is a research-based curriculum that teaches neuroscience, and also teaches social emotional learning, self-regulation, and helps improve attention. All critical skills. So there's more and more research that supports the benefits of mindfulness for children and youth and even adults. So it is something that we do work every day with our students on as well. Exercise is also a very important part of our program. Again, there's more studies that support the more physically active we are, the more malleable our brain becomes, the more capable of change. So many of our schools do running club in the morning, we do yoga, we're out every week for PE and outside every day at lunch. We also have movement breaks in the day, these short little activities that are fun and get our students, you know, out of their chairs, get their heart rates up a little bit, and also another opportunity to, you know, get those wiggles out, and then they can come back and focus more. We know that exercise is good for our bodies, but it's also very important for brain health as well. So we do try to incorporate as much physical activity with our students as possible. There's also lots of that going on. You know, we work with parents and families. You know, we understand that nutrition and diet is another key piece for the program and for the students' progress. You know, working to include those healthy snacks and nutritious lunches. You know, low glucose, high protein, lots of fresh water. You know, understanding our need for sleep and rest. To rejuvenate, to be able to come in and do this work, also very important. We also use growth mindset in all of our schools, and recognize the importance of community outreach as well. So I've got a lot going on at our schools, a lot that we're doing that these students are a part of, and we really believe it is this balance of the Arrowsmith program and the cognitive exercises with these other elements as well that help our students achieve success.
Thanks, Emily. You may have already seen that Emily is the principal of Eaton Arrowsmith White Rock. You probably said that and I wasn't listening. I also want to announce before questions from Australia, New Zealand, local Arbutus Club questions. Is it shown other places in the world? Anywhere, so wherever you are. An exciting development over the last month, the Faculty of Medicine at UBC, University of British Columbia, and the Faculty of Education, University of British Columbia, have two professors. Of course, one is Dr. Lara Boyd, Faculty of Medicine, who I talked about the research with, and the other one from the Faculty of Education is Kimberly Schoner-Reichel. They both want to and talked with me about starting the first ever collaborative in neuroscience and education at a Canadian university. And it will be called the Arrowsmith Young Collaborative for Neuroscience and Education. And it'll be centered at UBC. Again, it's the first ever in Canada, probably the fourth only in the world. Part of my work now in philanthropy is raising money for their collaborative. It's not going to just study Arrowsmith, that's not the purpose. The purpose is to study the brain in relationship to education. So we're looking at cognitive training. It doesn't have to be just Arrowsmith. There are many other programs going to develop over time. It's going to look at mindfulness or meditation mindfulness and the brain. It's going to look at exercise and the brain and education. It's going to take a very holistic approach and going to pick subjects that professors are interested in studying. It's going to bring in postdocs who will make a career of educational neuroscience, make a lifetime practice for them to teach at other universities. So it will create a new generation of researchers who want to look at the relationship between neuroscience and education. So very exciting development at the University of British Columbia. Again, we had the first meeting of philanthropists. About 30 philanthropists flew from around the world on their own dollar to UBC, some in their private planes, to come to UBC to listen to Dr. Boyd and Dr. Schoner-Reichel present their concept, and as well as from San Francisco, Boston, Toronto, Florida, from around North America, Switzerland. Some people came in from Switzerland. Now we're waiting for the development office at the Faculty of Medicine at UBC to present a budget of what the collaborative would cost, and then I'm out doing more fundraising. So if you have deep pockets anywhere around the world and you're interested in making sure work like this gets into public schools, because we need to do more research. We can't just do research at Eaton Arrowsmith School. We've got to go into the public schools and do this research. Give me a ring. Let me know you want to help and make a difference and make a possible donation to UBC and this collaborative. Could make a world of difference. So with that, questions from people. We have myself, Simon Hayes, and Emily Looney here as well. So questions. Who has questions? Yes?
How would you say medication would play a role in all that?
Yeah, so the question is, what role does medication and attention deficit hyperactivity disorder play in Arrowsmith in particular?
Yes, like medication.
Yeah, we get about, you know, 30% of kids diagnosed with learning disabilities or learning differences also are diagnosed with ADHD. And what's interesting with Arrowsmith that I found out, as students, you know, I got involved with this program 11 years ago. It was the first time I heard of it, and started the school about 11 years ago. And we'd have parents enroll who had kids with learning disabilities and attention disorder. And I remember phoning Barbara Arrowsmith Young in Toronto, because I was new to this, and said, what happens to the attention disorder part of their learning disability? And she said, well, you'll probably see in 60 to 70% of the cases that they won't need medication after doing Arrowsmith. And you say, why is that the case? Well, you remember the slide of the prefrontal lobe, the executive brain, at resting state, where before they came in, there was less activity at rest when they weren't thinking of anything? Possibly meaning the underusage of it in normal daily life. Well, after 3 months of intensive, resting state is lighting up more, significantly more than before. And that's the area of the brain for attention and executing on ideas. And if you can increase the power of that area of the brain, then the association is the medication wasn't a neurochemical problem for that child, it was a cognitive problem. It was a cognitive structural and functional problem, meaning that area of the brain just wasn't strong enough. And therefore, they were in class, losing focus, not paying attention to what happens. When I talk to adults doing the Arrowsmith program, one of the things they say is, I feel like I've been lifted out of a fog. I feel like I'm in real time now. And all of those are executive functioning feelings when you're engaged. I mean, when you do sports and after sports, you feel sort of alive. It's because your oxygen's flowed into the prefrontal lobe and you have that energy again. That's why movement's so important. That's why mindfulness is so important, because it engages that prefrontal lobe. But Arrowsmith, uniquely to their exercises, engages that executive prefrontal lobe, which reduces the attentional problems that many kids with ADHD have. I do believe there's a cohort of kids with ADHD or attention deficit, both, you know, maybe 30% that truly are neurochemical based, where medication does make a big difference. But this makes sense too, because the research on medication and grades for kids taking medication show there's minimal effect on grades. They don't get better as students. Well, why not? Well, neurologically, cognitively, they're still weak. But they can sit and stare at you longer and not move. But they still have these cognitive weaknesses. So I'm really excited for physicians, doctors involved in attention deficit disorder, to understand the implications of cognition. It's a whole other study that we could do on the Arrowsmith program, is look at the implications of cognitive training on the executive brain and the need for medication. I think we can dramatically reduce the need for meds with cognitive training programs, but they have to be intensive, repetitive, and usually more than just 8 to 12 weeks. And very targeted, and that's what differentiates Arrowsmith from all the other cognitive programs. It's also somewhat frustrating when people compare Arrowsmith to Luminosity or to Fast Forward. They're very different programs, and especially brain games on the internet. Most of those are an absolute waste of time and energy. Imagine this, one of the keys to success in these programs is to make sure you don't compensate, meaning if you're doing an exercise that requires visualization, don't talk through the exercise, because you're using your strength, auditory. So we have to make sure these kids aren't compensating as they do these exercises. Now, if you're at home and you want to beat a brain game, you're going to use compensations, because you want to have a good score. You don't even know you're compensating. Most of us have these cognitive weaknesses, and we compensate all the time, and we don't know it. We might use our wife to read the map as GPS as we drive. I mean, thank God some of us have these GPSs now. Before, we had the paper maps and we'd have to read them. Or you might go to parties with your wife, who knows the names of everybody, because you don't know the names of everybody, and you stay right close to her because she can tell you who's coming. So we all have these built-in compensations where we neglect our cognitive weaknesses. The kids in Arrowsmith are not neglecting them. We are targeting them for intervention. In schools, in terms of learning resource rooms, in classrooms, we tell them to cope and bypass their learning weaknesses because the mindset is it's fixed. That is not true. And that's the mindset that has to change. And research is beginning to show that more and more. So that's a big long answer to your question. Yes, other questions? Is there a question?
We had a question about how long does it take in a summer intensive program or a clocks intensive program to see change. So we offer as of last year, the Arrowsmith program is offering a 6-week clocks intensive. So you saw Kaylin and Michael doing the clocks here. Typically over the course of the year, they do that once a day for 35 minutes for an entire school year. And for some kids, it's 2 to 3 school years. The Arrowsmith program now has an offering of every single day for roughly 6 to 7 hours a day for 6 weeks to do the clocks program. So if you do the math, that it equates to roughly a year in 6 weeks, about that much time that you could spend on that. So the question was, how long does it take to make progress? And the reports that we've had back after doing it for 2 successful summers has been about 2 weeks. We start to see noticeable differences in the students working on their reasoning abilities and their processing challenges within the school. After 2 weeks.
And just so that you know too, the researchers at Southern Illinois University and UBC, they're gonna be studying the 6-week clocks intensive as independent research projects to look at the benefit of changes as students work through the clocks program. There's no question that the clocks program is one of the most powerful programs that is within the Arrowsmith program. A group of exercises in terms of the changes that we see in students' lives. And there's so many reasons neurologically for it. And once these articles get published, you'll see more in-depth analysis as to why some of these exercises are having the change that they're doing in their behavior. Question back here.
Yeah, I'm pretty new to having, so I appreciate being here. With this clocks program, that's a computer-based program, is that right?
That's right.
So during that,
there's also a paper pencil aspect to it. So it's not just on the computer. There has to be some mastery of drawing clocks as well, and being able to read time on a paper clock. So they actually at times create these clocks, and then they master that, and then they go onto their computer. So it's a bit of pencil, paper, and computer.
I'm just curious in relation to the blue light and the impacts on cognitive function. Is that something that you guys are aware of or look at? Or
not aware of it. Okay. Yes, but I'm going to Google it now. I'll talk to you after about. Is that on the computer? You mean the
well,
light?
Well, yeah, the computer. Yeah.
Yeah, that's why they have the spectrum glasses. You're aware of.
Right. Yeah. So they have the glasses.
So, yeah.
Okay.
So my son is in the.
Great.
Is in the part-time program.
Yeah.
He's 25.
Okay.
Anyway, the first thing I did was glasses.
Yeah.
So what just occurred here in the audience around the world is a parent here uses blue glasses to handle the blue spectrum light.
No, they're actually not blue.
They're what yellow. Color? Yellow light.
Blockers.
Yellow.
Glasses. But they block the blue light.
So the yellow blocks out the blue.
Yes.
Yes.
So it doesn't affect the melatonin.
So it doesn't affect the melatonin. Okay.
Because from the time you wake up, you've got 12 hours until one gland shuts off and the other gland starts activating. So you want them to sleep properly. And if the kids aren't going to sleep, if their adrenaline is rushing at night, you're going to have another problem.
Cool to know. I learn stuff every day. So thank you. Yes, back here.
What about kids with low working memory?
Yes, so working memory is also, it's all over the human brain in terms of visual working memory, auditory working memory. One of the research projects we have underway is with Dr. Rachel Weber, who's at UBC. She's working with Dr. Lara Boyd, and they're actually doing a working memory executive functioning study that's underway now. We actually need control students for that research, and if you're interested, if you have a child, you want to do some brain imaging and behavioral testing, you're interested in working memory, talk to...
There's information
at the front about the working memory study by Dr. Rachel Weber. But given that, there's no question that working memory is impacted with the Arrowsmith program in terms of numerical working memory, auditory working memory for words and language. So it's constantly, depending on your profile. Now remember, each student that comes in receives the Arrowsmith assessment. Each student is a uniquely different brain, and therefore they have a uniquely different group of exercises. Some seem to be more common exercises than others, like pretty much everyone does clocks, but some are doing, you know, lexical memory, which is word lists and those kind of things, in terms of working memory capacity. So, yes, some come in with significant working memory, usually related to executive processing as well, and we're seeing changes that research will be publishing about. And again, we're doing new research with Dr. Rachel Weber, who's going to study it in isolation of other factors of cognition. So we'll get more research published from that.
Thank you.
Yes?
You guys are talking about the holistic approach of the diet and exercise in
Yes.
schools. I'm curious to know what's done for a sensory diet, like term sensory diet versus...
I'm not aware of sensory diet.
Oh, it's just a buzzword, but what have they done to?
Well, sensory integration. Yeah, so I think, you know, obviously, you know, in our classrooms, you know, you walk through the school, it's like no one's there. I used to be principal the first 3 years of the school, and I would come in from a meeting downtown, and I'd come through the school and not looking and just walk straight to my principal's office, which was across, right through the hallways of the school, and sit down and say, was anyone here? Then get up and walk back out. It was just so... focus the group. So we do things like headphones, like earphones if there's sensory for noise. We have different types of seating arrangements if there's motor issues that might be of need. And we also refer out to many professionals who might be experts on sensory integration disorder. We don't pretend to know everything. And so we'll refer to ophthalmologists, OTs, speech therapists, that might offer more. We don't pretend Arrowsmith is everything. We really believe in working with specialists. So some of our kids, after doing Arrowsmith, will work with intensive phonics teachers, or Gillingham, or the Reading Foundation, or Linda Mood Bell. Some kids need Arrowsmith to build the breadbasket, we call, of cognitive skills for reading, and then benefit from reading instruction. And so they might be with us for 2 years. These are severely... kids with severe dyslexia, who have almost every cognitive function related to reading is weak. And we have to target each of these different subskills of reading, cognition, ability, build these cognitive domains like we do with the prefrontal, and then refer to Reading Foundation or Orton Gillingham tutors, or they go to another private school like Fraser Academy or Kenneth Gordon School, and then they benefit. But they couldn't benefit before, because they didn't have the cognitive capacity to do it. And I was actually an Orton Gillingham tutor. Orton Gillingham is a phonetic method of teaching reading, writing, and spelling. I was trained by the guru of Orton Gillingham, Diana King, at Camp Dunnebeck, which was a Kildonan school. And I'd work with kids with dyslexia. And I'm dyslexic, so I sort of understand dyslexia pretty deeply. And I would tutor these kids, and some kids would, you know, I was with them 3 months, and they were like great readers, and I was going, oh, what a great teacher, what a great tutor. And others, I was with them for a year, and we're just getting through sight words, that like a deck of 50 sight words, and they would like forget them still. And I didn't understand why. Why isn't Orton Gillingham or Linda Mubello or these phonics methods working for everybody? Until I got into Barbara Arrowsmith Young's mind and her conceptualization of reading and said, aha, well, if you don't have some of these cognitive subskills, and they're all weak, programs like Orton Gillingham or Linda Mubello may not be as effective. And any reading academic researcher knows there are these non-responders in research. These are kids or students in your research design that don't seem to have, you can't change their reading ability. But you still have enough that respond that you get significant results. And so this program is the best program for dyslexia. But there are a group of them in that research design that were non-responders. And they'll be the same with the Arrowsmith program. And we need to know why they're not responding to Arrowsmith, like they're not responding to a phonetic program. So yes, that's a roundabout way to answer the question. I forget what the question was, but there we go. Yes.
I'm curious about the 35 minutes on any one of them, because I understood that if you're 5 years old, you can concentrate for 5 minutes. You're 7 years old, you can concentrate for 7 minutes, and that even if you're my age, you shouldn't really push for more than 15 minutes. You should change your activity.
Yeah.
So I'm just concerned about the Why 35 minutes?
In terms of the last 35 years of the Arrowsmith program, Barbara Arrowsmith Young has found that's sort of the maximum amount per day for that exercise over 5 days that we get the change we need. Now, keep in mind, one of the things that Dr. Lara Boyd's researching that I'm really interested in is who are these great responders? Who seem to be more neuroplastic than others? And what they're finding is the ones who seem to have the best progress have the strongest attention span and executive ability. So they're able to sustain attention for longer periods of time. The average progressors seem to have average attention span, and ones who progress not as quickly have the weaker attention span. So, and as you can see, it's slowly being built over time. But if you come in with a fairly strong attention span, the research seems to indicate you progress faster. Now, if you come in at age 8 years of age, you're going to have in that classroom that variety of kids, some with remarkable attention span, some with average, and some very low. And the cognitive teachers have to be aware of their frustration. And one of the things they don't do is push you to the point that you can't do it and you're in tears and you're throwing things at the teacher. So there's a lot of TLC and awareness of everybody's individual attention span and just trying to push it farther and farther as they progress. But certainly not to the point where it's, they're despondent and hate being there. And if that happens, they shouldn't do the program, right? It's not the right time.
But that's what I was actually addressing, is that I thought that trying to expand the attention span was old school.
No, it's the key. It's the key to learning. William James, a professor at Harvard, late 1800s, early 1900s, he did a lot of writing about education. And he said, the most important thing an educator can do is work on attention. Because attention drives brain change. Without it, we can't, that's the nervous thing, that's the scary thing about ADHD. Imagine kids in the classroom with low attention span and what that means to brain change and their ability to engage and alter function neurologically. They're at such a disadvantage for that. And so the key to, I think, we have as educators, in terms of what I've read with leading academic figures in educational thinking, is attention is one of the most important things we can work with kids. For example, mindfulness is all about attention. When I practice mindfulness, I sit at home on my cushion. And when I first started, oh my God, I thought I was schizophrenic or clinically insane. I'd have one thought every 10 seconds, or go into one thought and mind drift on that thought for like 10 minutes and realize, oh my God, I was just off on this story that was all fake and unreal, but it was an exaggeration of the mind. And as I progressed with mindfulness, I could focus on my heartbeat for an hour without losing focus. That's attention span. And I think I do it in my work. When I get focused on something, I don't hear anyone around me. I'm just so hyper-focused on it. Unfortunately, when I'm not, I'm a disturbance to everyone who I'm working with because I'm asking all sorts of questions. But building attention in the executive brain is huge for learning disabilities and everybody else in the world because it gives you that power of thought and sustained focus that drives brain change. Grows the mind. Certainly that's what research is saying, that's what theorists have talked about all the time.
How permanent are the changes?
The Barbara Arrowsmith Young has had people come back after 20 years and retest them on the Arrowsmith assessment and show same pre and post development. So they didn't change. I think the critical thing though is stimulating mental stimulation. And not living in a toxic environment. The stress kills neural. Stress is neurodegenerational. It'll kill brain cell stress. So you have to have toxicity. So you have to have a life of some happiness and not too much stress in order to make sure your brain is functioning well. But you also have to be in mental stimulation. So here's an example. I think there was a study from CogMed in Germany following a group of children who did CogMed and a group of unemployed adults who did CogMed. The children showed long-term sustaining of their cognitive change. And imagine they're in school, right? So they're mentally being stimulated all the time. The unemployed adults showed a loss of cognitive ability because they weren't, unless they had a job, they were back to their normal sort of activities that doesn't drive brain change. So that research, for example, we had Alvaro Fernandez up, who's the CEO of Sharp Brains, and he was talking about mental stimulation and the importance of it. It's made us actually look at our young adult program, our adult program, and look at vocational rehabilitation and post-secondary studies, and making sure part of our program for young adults is get them engaged in mental stimulation activities, volunteering at a workplace, enrolling in a college, get that brain that we've boosted neurologically engaged in mental stimulation. Because you could lose what you gain.
Are video games considered mental stimulation?
Depends what kind of video games. And I think, you know, there's people who talk about, you know, games that expand visual spatial thinking, that you're covering tracts of territory. I remember my son Sean was playing a computer game of course, I don't know all the names. I just don't get engaged in them. But it required him to know a landscape that wasn't available to him. He had to remember what the landscape was in visual spatial memory. And I remember just watching him and amazed how he knew to get places that weren't on the screen. And so it was building this visual spatial capacity. You know, so I do think there are games that build cognitive capacities. There is. Findings that Barbara Arrowsmith Young has seen is that over the use of technology over the last 30 years, she's seeing more and more individuals with executive functioning problems. So, and that's like artificial intelligence issues, like our iPads, our watches are giving us information that I think our executive brain used to give us. So, you know, and then, you know, so is technology actually advantageous for neurological development? It's a big question. And Elon Musk and Stephen Hawking have argued about the danger of technology in terms of the human brain, socialization, all sorts. And they're actually wanting to start an institute about, you know, artificial intelligence and actually assessing the benefit or not of it. So I think there's pros and cons. It depends what you're doing. Certainly with technology in the executive functioning brain, what we're seeing is more executive functioning problems as over the decades.
Yes. We had a really great online question, and it's actually for our courageous students here. We're wondering, what is the hardest part of the program, and what is the best part of the program? For me, the hardest part is probably the area that I'm really weak in, like, for instance, phrases, probably one of my least favorite, if you don't count Broca's. But for me, it's like, it's really hard because you're really weak in that area and you're working on something that you can't really do properly in the brain. And then for me, the funnest part is probably clocks. I mastered Zip's hands because I loved it so much.
Just so you know, phrases is the ability to remember you know, groups of sentences and recall them.
Thank you, Julia. Anyone else?
Yeah, the most difficult thing is sometimes you have those days where you're doing the exercises and you're thinking, just get me home, just I want to sleep. You don't really have the drive to do the exercises because sometimes your brain is just so tired because the program is just so demanding and it just drains all your energy. And when you get home and you feel like you just pass out for like 15, 20 hours. So the hardest part is overcoming the feeling that of, you know, I don't want to do this. So that's the hardest part for me, is overcoming the reluctancy for that given day. And for me, the best part is seeing the results from the program in everyday life, whether it's from whether my parents notice it, my peers notice it, or I personally notice it. And once you have people and your close friends tell you that you've changed, then you get that instant gratification and validation that, and you think, okay, this is really working. Now it gives me more motivation to get in the morning. Now you get to enjoy it. Once you see results come in, that's when the fun begins, and that's when you don't really consider this program work, but more as a like a workout per se. You're just like, it's like going to the gym for your brain. Instead of lifting weights and working on your triceps or biceps, you're just working on your neurological networks. So that's, to me, are the both that work on both ends of the spectrum.
Thank you. I think one of the interesting things for me, I've got 5 minutes, is the paradigm shift. When I was, prior to Arrowsmith program, I was in public schools in the state of Massachusetts, schools here in Vancouver. I was a certified elementary and high school teacher, worked with kids with LD in classrooms. And the idea was to make it easy for them to survive school so they could graduate. Find a way to get them through. Make sure they're not stressed out. And the reasoning was because these are lifelong. You gotta feel empathy for them. They can't help but be dysfunctional at school because of their neurological weaknesses. As I absorbed Arrowsmith and got involved with the Arrowsmith program, I realized that paradigm is so wrong. If we allow these kids in schools to just get by, we're creating a brain that isn't as effective as if we challenge it. But the challenge has to be fair. And that's the beauty of the Arrowsmith program. It gets kids at a level that they can actually engage in these difficult cognitive exercises, but master it. And when they master, guess what we do to you? We'll make it a bit harder, but just enough so you could do it. And as we build these cognitive skills, they begin to say, I'm in control of my learning. I'm in control of my life. No one else is in charge of me anymore. No one's making it easier for me. Control is inside. It's not from elsewhere. The only person to blame for not moving forward is myself. It's a very different way to look at the world. And it's a very different way to look at the field of learning disabilities or differences. But that's a paradigm shift. Hard work, effort is good for kids with learning disabilities. It's not a bad thing. And I know some people who walk into the Arrowsmith classroom and the parent says, my kid will never be able to do this. It looks so hard. And some don't come back. But most do, which is good. But because they've been taught that difficult things are too much for my child. And I challenge people out there in YouTube land to rethink that concept. Because I know, in my experience, and thousands of kids who've done Arrowsmith, and the teachers who are involved in it, and other schools around the world, that there's another way to see this field. And it's revolutionary, and it freaks, worries the other side of the paradigm, because they're so used to what they do. But I ask them to switch on the open mind, and let go of fear, and learn, and go to Arrowsmith program school, get engaged in it. Yes, some of you may want the research, that's coming. There is research out there already. It's not that there's been no research, but there will be more that comes. But unfortunately, there'll be some, even with that research, who will say, ooh, that's too much. But we got a collaborative starting. We're going to train doctoral students to be professors of educational neuroscience to begin this trend. Maybe by the time I pass away, we'll got into universities, public schools, we'll be doing Arrowsmith around North America. I hope so. But anyways, I want to thank you tonight. I want to thank the students, first of all. I want to let everyone know I have no idea what they're going to say. I don't even know who comes to. So none of this is put in advance. There's no rehearsal of this. This is absolutely live. So I always go, oh, God, I hope they say good things. But they did, so thank you. I want to thank Emily Looney, principal of EAS White Rock, and Simon Hayes, principal of EAS Vancouver, and the other staff that are around, Sandra Husel, Rose McLaughlin, Jenna Kelly, and Sarah Cohen and Mark Leesdale for setting this up, and all of you for being here at the Arbutus Club, and have a good evening.